In this topic, you have learned force is one which changes or tends to change the state of rest or of uniform motion of a body. Forces acting on an object which do not change the state of rest or of uniform motion of it are called balanced forces. When two opposite forces of different magnitudes act on an object, the forces are unbalanced and the object starts moving in the direction of the greater force.
In simplest terms, we can define force as a push or a pull. A ball will remain in place till it is kicked off with a great force. So, we can say that force is an influence which tends to set a stationary body in motion. This kicked off ball will remain in motion till it is hit by a bat, which changes the direction of motion of the ball. Thus, force also tends to change the speed and direction of a moving body. Now, after catching the ball, if you squeeze the rubber ball, it changes shape. Thus, force can also change the shape of a body. We cannot see force, but we can certainly see its effects. A brick is placed on a wooden table and is attached to a spring balance. Pull gently with force F. The block initially does not move. The force F that you apply is not sufficient enough to overcome the frictional force FR between the table and the brick. Since F is less than FR, the object remains static. Thus, friction is a force. On pulling it harder, the brick starts to move. Thus, if the applied force F is slightly greater than the frictional force FR, then the object starts to move. If more force is applied, the brick starts to accelerate.
Consider a boy trying to move a fully packed box. The box moves with some speed. Now another boy joins him. Guess what happens? Of course, the box will now move with greater speed. Because two forces are acting on the object from the same direction, then the forces will get added and the object moves along the resultant direction. If two equal forces are opposite to each other, then the object will not move, because the forces are cancelling each other. The net force acted on the object due to a number of forces is known as resultant force.
How to recognize the presence of a net force? When there are several forces acting on an object, and one of the forces is greater than the others, then the forces are unbalanced, and there is a net force acting in one direction. Thus, net force is the vector sum of all the forces acting on a body simultaneously. If the forces are unbalanced or there is a net force on the objects, then it experiences a change in velocity or acceleration. At the end of the topic, you will be able to understand Newton's first law of motion, define momentum, verify Newton's second law of motion, describe Newton's third law of motion, relate to some of the applications of Newton's third law.
Early thinkers like Aristotle, Galileo, and others had many ideas about force and motion. Isaac Newton arrived at the correct notion of force in his famous laws of motion. Newton's first law states that an object continues to be in a state of rest or in motion at constant velocity, unless acted upon by an unbalanced force. Note that there is no distinction in the law between an object at rest and that in motion with constant velocity. Why? Because both the objects have zero net force. This implies that an object with no force acting on it is same as an object with several forces that balance one another having a net force of zero. Newton's first law is also called the law of inertia. We now know that when there is unbalanced force acting on a body, it will accelerate.
Look at this man trying to roll the stone. Consider the forces acting on the stone.
We realize that the forces are unbalanced. Then, why didn't the stone roll over? It is due to inertia. This property of the body to preserve its state of rest is called inertia of rest. Quickly, strike the coin at the bottom with a pen or hammer. Observe that the rest of the coins simply move down rather than falling from the stack. Try the same with a stack of books. Now, let us learn what is inertia of motion. Daily experience tells us that an object that is moving eventually come to rest because of the external forces acting on it. A rolling ball stops very soon due to the frictional force. If friction is reduced, the ball rolls a greater distance. The ball will never stop as it rolls on a frictionless floor. Thus, a body continues to be in uniform motion unless acted upon by external force. The first law states that all objects have inertia. The more mass an object has, the more inertia it has. And the harder it is to change its motion or make it move. We can define moment of a force as a product of the magnitude of the force and the perpendicular distance from the point of application of the force to the fixed point about which the body will turn. Moment of force is equal to force into perpendicular distance. What is the unit of the moment of force? We know that moment of force is equal to the force into perpendicular distance. The unit of moment of force in SI unit is Newton meter. In CGS unit, it is dyne centimeter. Moment is a vector quantity. The force required to stop a moving body depends on two factors. One, its mass, and two, its velocity. Newton defined momentum as a product of the mass and velocity of a body. If P denotes the momentum of a body of mass m moving with a uniform velocity v, P is equal to m into v. Unit of momentum. Momentum is a product of mass and velocity of an object. Momentum is equal to mass into velocity. In SI units, P is equal to momentum has units of kilogram into meter per second. M is equal to mass, usually measured in kilogram. V is equal to velocity, usually measured in meters per second or kilometers per hour. In CGS system of units, the unit of momentum is gram into centimeter per second. An accurate method of measuring force. Consider a body of mass m moving with the initial velocity u. Force is applied on it in the same direction of motion. Then, its velocity increases to v after some time t. Force applied on it in the same direction of motion increases the velocity. Thus, initial momentum is equal to m into u. Final momentum is equal to m into v. Therefore, Change in momentum is equal to m into v minus m into u, and the rate of change of momentum is m into v minus m into u by t. By Newton's law, rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the applied force, so we have F directly proportional to M into V minus M into U by T. Further simplification, we get F is directly proportional to M into V minus U by T. We know that V minus U is a change of velocity, and V minus U by T is a rate of change of velocity, which is the acceleration A. So, now we have F is directly proportional to M into A. Replacing the proportionality by a constant K, we get A is equal to K into F by M. When K is equal to 1, then A is equal to F by M, and so F is equal to M into A. Here are some more information on how K is equal to 1. Thus, K is a constant of proportionality whose numerical value will depend on the units used for F, M and A. For convenience, we choose a unit of force in such a way that a unit force produces a unit acceleration in a unit mass, that is, 1 is equal to K into 1 into 1, which gives K is equal to 1. If the unit is fixed in this manner, F is equal to M into A.
In the SI system, the unit of force is Newton. A Newton is defined as that force which produces an acceleration of 1 meter per second squared in a body of mass 1 kg. The dimensions of force are MLT to the power minus 2. In the SI system, the unit of force is Newton. A Newton is defined as that force which produces an acceleration of 1 meter per second squared in a body of mass 1 kg. The dimensions of force are MLT to the power minus 2.
When looking at a moving object, we realize that it moves due to single resultant force acting in the particular direction of motion. But Newton stated that it is impossible to have a single force. There is always a reaction to this force, so forces occur in pairs called action-reaction pair. The law states that for every action there is equal and opposite reaction. It can also be stated as for every force there is equal and opposite force. Some examples of action-reaction forces are: weight of the apple is the action on the palm of your hand. The force the palm exerts on the apple is the reaction. The shooting of the bullet is the action, and the recoil of the gun is the reaction. While hammering a nail to a wooden plank, the force of hammer on the nail is the action, and the nail exerting a force on the hammer is a reaction.
Click the animation button to view Newton's laws of motion.
Newton's law can be stated also as whenever two bodies exert force on each other, the two forces are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. Take two spring balances that are coupled together. The balances show the same reading, indicating that both the action and reaction forces are equal and opposite. In this case, the pull of either of the two spring balances can be regarded as action, and that of the other balance as the reaction. Newton's law states that for every action, there is equal and opposite reaction. Let us take an example of the Newton's third law of motion of the boatman rowing a boat. According to Newton's third law, if the boatman pushes on the water in a direction, it pushes him back with the same force in the opposite direction. Applying Newton's second law, F is equal to del M into V by del T. Since the force and the time are the same, both the boatman and the water will experience the same momentum, but in opposite direction. What is this momentum? Momentum is the movement of a mass. If a mass is moving, it is said to have momentum. Momentum depends on the mass of the body and velocity. Thus, momentum is defined as a product of mass and velocity, and it is a vector quantity. But what is the overall change in momentum? Yes, you are right. There is equal change in opposite direction, and so they cancel out. So, the overall change in momentum is zero. This is known as the principle of conservation of momentum, which states that the total momentum of a system is a constant. Proof of conservation of momentum. Suppose we have two balls moving with different velocity. Say ball 1 has mass m1 and is moving with a velocity u1, and ball 2 has mass m2 and it moves with a velocity u2. These two balls after collision move with velocities v1 and v2. Now the change in the momentum of the first ball, m1 into v1 minus m1 into u1, which is the reaction. Change in momentum of ball 2 is m2 into v2 minus m2 into u2 is the action. According to Newton's third law, action is equal to minus of reaction. M1 into V1 minus M1 into U1 is equal to minus the whole M2 into V2 minus M2 into U2. Rearranging, we get M1 into U1 plus M2 into U2 is equal to M1 into V1 plus M2 into V2. If many number of bodies, say, balls undergo collision, then the total momentum of the bodies before collision is equal to the total momentum just after collision. We see that the total momentum before and after the collision remains the same when there is external unbalanced force acting on them. In other words, momentum is conserved. It remains unchanged after the collision.
In this topic, you have learnt that every body continues to be in its state of rest or of uniform motion in a straight line unless acted upon by an external force. This is Newton's first law of motion. The acceleration of a body is directly proportional to the resultant force acting on it and inversely proportional to its mass. This is Newton's second law of motion. The unit of force in the CGS system is dyne and in MKS system is Newton. Momentum is the product of velocity and mass. If two or more bodies collide with one another, the total momentum is conserved.